And we're back. This is the RPG Chick. We're about ready to head into Dyrford Village. These people over here think there's a woman who's a murderer in the town, and we're not sure. They do not look official. They cross the bridge for the first time. House Harand Guard. Word, traveler. I only require a moment. The guard gives you an appraising eye. You've recently come to Dyrford, I take it. Yeah, this last episode. I don't suppose you saw a young elven noblewoman on the road. I'm stuck in this wretched place with the rest of my unit until we find her. Who is she? Lord Aelis. He bites his lip. She's the daughter of Lord Nestor Harand, and she's gone missing. Perhaps you could go speak with Lord Harand at the inn. He'll be grateful for the assistance, and it could be the villagers will open up to you more than they have to us. Lord Harand is sick with worry for her and fears that the townsfolk are intentionally keeping something from her. If you find Lady Aelis, escort her to the Dracogen Inn with all haste. Make haste and all that. What's this place? Dyrford Mill. Well, let's just head in there and then we'll look around outside some more. The mill slowly grinds away at a trough of grain.
And what does the flame reveal?
I don't know. What's in here? There's a hidden thing in there, too.
Now this I haven't seen before.
Green, I don't want that.
You can trust me.
Ooh, a peridot. Rice, we don't want that either. Nah. Keep the peridot, though. I'm sure they didn't even know it was there. I don't want to camp, I want to turn that off. Villager. Have you been to Defiance Bay? I heard there's no Hollowborn there. Can't remember the last time we'd had a healthy birth in the village. That's it? There's nobody here to talk to. Alright. Check out some of the lay of the land here. Nothing to pick, nothing to gather. I gather. Piglets. Almost didn't see that. Pilgrim's Crown. A villager. That lord will have bigger problems if his guard keeps pushing us around. Hold up. Harren's men already asked us about the girl. What more do they want? Winfred's pleasant enough, but once you get him talking... Surprised we can't pick that stuff. Yeah, I could keep that. More Pilgrim's Crown. Good, because we need that for enchanting. It's really being thorough here. Trying to, anyway. The woman looks briefly through you as if she doesn't know you're there. Grieving Mother. Cool portrait. This middle-aged peasant woman is dressed in a brown leather cloth draped down to her knees. Her hands are working at separating stringy, colorless vegetables in a pile before her, stripping the heads off the long, fibrous stems with a paring knife. She discards the stems one by one, placing the heads of the vegetables into a small, cradle-like basket in front of her. She doesn't greet you as you approach. You're not sure she even knows you're there. Excuse me? The woman doesn't respond. She keeps stripping the heads from the vegetables with a steady rhythm. She may be deaf. There's no indication she heard you. Study her. At first glance, she seems nothing more than a middle-aged woman. Unremarkable, maybe less stern than most, who seems more focused on the weaving in her lap than her surroundings. Yet you suddenly notice she's not stripping the vegetables before her any longer. She's weaving, and the vegetable pots are now missing. What? She still pays you no mind, her brown locks torn and snagged from lack of washing. Like many of the townsfolk you've seen, there's a strange blur to her. Even the motions of her hands seem to be playing with threads that lack color in a shape that lacks interest. Odd. It may be that she is half-minded, or deaf, but something feels wrong. As you watch, her knitting takes on an odd cadence, and you have a terrible suspicion that something lurks beneath what your eyes are showing you. Well, she's probably a ghost or something, right? She's not really completely there on the corporeal plane, something like that. Focus on the woman. Her brown hair is long, almost impossibly to the length of her hands. As you follow the streams of her locks downwards, the hairs become long and black, splitting off into threads of black and silver and wrapping around her hands. She is forming a soul cradle with the threads, braiding a net in front of you, each finger long and sharp like a series of knitting needles, almost hypnotic. The silver and black strands of her hair weave together, with silver predominating as a highlight, the black shadowing it. And suddenly, you are calm. You are on a plateau, almost the height of a tower, several stories high. The plateau is like a table lying beneath a clear sky, and beneath the plateau, surrounding it in all directions, a forest, hazy with mist. Although whether it is actual mist or distance or a recollection. Blech. Resting in the curve of a natural arch above you is a great copper bell, half again the size of a man, hanging at attention, as if looking down at you in the event unfolding before you. The plateau has soaked in the sun, and the rock beneath you is tough and warm, or rough and warm, rather. The sky forms a cradle around you. You feel different, not disembodied, but you feel your body, your physical contours have changed along with the surroundings. And you hear a soft series of chimes, like wind chimes. At the sound, the scene gains color and texture, as if the sound is beckoning you gently forth, filling your senses and thoughts like mist roiling softly into a sealed chamber. And, focus on the chimes. The chime coaxes you deeper into the memory, and you're certain it is a memory, a warm one. You are on the stone of the plateau, your knees on the warm texture of the ground, silver, white, shimmering like Aedra. The plateau is formed of it, glistening in the sun. You can feel the heat on your skin, your wrists, and your hands. Your hands are in motion. weaving, not thread, but gathering, tenderly moving across along the first movements of Barath's wheel. Your hands are wet. Your hands are upon the flesh of a newborn child, and you can feel the crowning of a tiny head turning in your grip, its head slick, wet from the womb. The hands you are wearing, inhabiting, have done this many times, and they are practiced and confident. You can feel distant pains in your own head as the head emerges, a stream of fluid from the womb helping the newborn slide forth, and a woman's labored breathing, crying out. Focus on the child, the movement of your hands. As your hands move, you hear the sound of chimes, clear, cutting through the haze of memory. You cannot see where they are coming from, but they are close, and they are meant as a comfort. Of that you are certain. Draw the child forth. And coaxed by your hands, every movement causing the chimes to sound again. Almost eagerly, the child comes forth, and as it does, your hands are in motion, weaving, weaving, moving along the length of a soft, wet rope, no, an umbilical cord, from the legs of the naked woman before you. You are holding a small child, still wet from the womb, before you. The child cries out, its cry full of life, full of soul, the ringing of chimes echoing in its thoughts, filling it with its welcome. The soul is blurred at the edges, as if you are viewing a soul from within a soul, but it is there, it is alive. The woman before you is weeping, and at her first cry, her hands reach out for it. Surrender the child. You surrender the child to her, something you have done many times before, and as your hands move, the chimes echo the movement, and you realize the chimes are hanging from cords on your wrists, and where they once echoed in the memory, they are now echoing in the child's mind as well. The chimes were intended to welcome the child, to be its first gentle greeting into the world, a soothing sound guided by the tender motions of your wrists. You are helping to weave its thoughts, its perceptions, and the experience. The experience. The woman laughs with a ragged joy, laughing from a parched throat. Her emotions seem soothed, but the physical demands of her labor have left her exhausted. But the child is there, the child is safe, and all atop the plateau is peaceful, calm, distant, flattening out as the memory persists. With effort, the scene bleeds of color, and your mind becomes your own again. There is no pull, no anchor, yet the sound of the chimes remain. As they existed in the memory, they sound here as well, and they are hanging from woven braids on the wrists of the woman before you. Even as your head is spinning from the touch of her mind, the sound of the chimes on her wrists are sharp and clear, as if coaxing you back to the real world. The woman still sits before you, but now she is nothing like what you first saw. She is wearing black, shredded garments that drape over her form like streamers. Her hair is streaks of black and run through with silver. Her age is almost impossible to tell. She simply feels old, like a crumbled watchtower. As she lifts her head to face you, you see that her hair is draped across the front of her face like a veil. What you first saw of her was a mental glamour of some sort, unconscious, and you realize what you see is not what the world sees, and you are perhaps the first to see her true self. Still, you don't sense a threat in the realization. If anything, you feel a sense of relief from the figure. You can hear her thoughts, and she is glad to at last be seen. What was that?
I am seen, but the eyes of others do not remember. You were the first to see me as I am, the call stripped aside.
There's a light touch on your mind, a caress, and her left hand mirrors the motion of the touch, reaching up to the air between you. You hear the chime on her wrist sound softly. Her hand plumbs as if pantomiming, resting on your cheek at a distance, and she speaks softly and slowly.
Your memories. A cadence of wheels on a caravan track. Fever. Questions by running water. Violence in a night's campfire. Arrows in the dark. And fleeing. Falling rock and cracking stone. And a storm. The storm.
She's talking about the caravan at the beginning of the game. She swallows and the chime sounds as her hand shakes. Then she stops, her hand frozen in the air. The storm.
The storm that brushed you, did its screaming wake you from your mind's cradle? Your memory of it is painful. Its cry is difficult to ignore. It's like a child. Many children crying out.
I encountered a Biowek, yes, and it did something to me. Her hand withdraws shyly, the chime sounding softly once again. The woman stands uncertainly, as if she had been sitting for some time, or is too weak to bear her own weight. You notice her cheekbones are tight, her face gaunt. Yet while her stance is weak, she seems determined to stand before you.
You are able to see me.
It is almost a question. You suddenly realize she doesn't seem to know what you saw when you looked at her. The image on the plateau. Yet the image was so clear, so sharp, you're surprised she didn't feel you there.
To see me is a rare gift. A watcher's gift.
Oh, I wonder what that requirement is. It doesn't say. That's for the first time I saw that. Torn between 2 and 3. I'll go 2, just because I'm a cipher. It felt like a pathway between our minds, but strange, gentle.
So many questions, thoughts, whirling like storm winds. That storm still roars through you, deep beneath your thoughts, yet muted and secret, like an underground river. I cannot tell if it is carving new channels or eroding what keeps your true strength buried.
I don't know if you guys can hear that, but the S sound she makes is like distorted somehow. The S's are too loud.
The fact that you could hear it at all, survive it, is something few have ever done. Your power will grow stronger with each soul you touch, as it allowed you to reach out to mine.
It's not as noticeable in this passage. There is silence, and although it seems to last for but a heartbeat, in your thoughts it stretches out between the two of you, like a pull between your minds. You blink, take a breath, and then you realize she wants to ask you a question, yet can't form the words, as if assembling them is painful, or there simply are not enough pieces. Assemble the thought. Do you wish to travel with me? We're going to leave behind. Or is she just going to appear as a companion? You feel a wave of fear, gusted with the strength of relief, although oddly, her expression does not change. The fear dissipates, and you feel strength and certainty, as if the plateau from her memory lies beneath you, and a calm sky looks down upon you. She's a cipher. Oh, could I have that druid guy? If I recruit her... Okay, I think she'd be at the stronghold then. Right? So I should go back to the druid and let him join the stronghold. Well, that's interesting. That was interesting. I'm sure I'll need to gather her at some point. St. Jiren's Horn. A ripple sponge. It's a butterfly dude. Not many new faces these days. Most are eager to leave Dyrford. That lord staying at the Dracogen has just about worn out his welcome. Really? Potions for sale. Potions and ow. Oh.
Gods keep you.
A young woman leans against a wagon. One arm and one side of her face are covered in bandages, with raw, rippled flesh showing underneath. A minty, tangy scent wafts from her dressing. She smiles painfully. Just ventured into town? I'm about dry on some of my stocks, but you're welcome to have a look-see. How did you get burned? She turns her face to the ground. By the flame, how bad does it look? Terrible, I know it. Number three is sad, it's so sad. Who cares how it looks? What matters is that you're okay. Suppose you're right. Good thing I know my poultices. I've been keeping an eye on a drake's nest, east of town, at Dyrford Crossing. The beast stayed just long enough to lay a clutch and moved on. Thank the Sky Mother it wasn't a full-grown dragon. She looks at her bandaged arm and grimaces. Fresh eggs are much more useful than the ones that get passed between merchants or left in nests for weeks or more, and that clutch looked to be at its peak. Thought I'd be getting an egg, but I didn't realize so many of them had already hatched, or that young worms were so territorial. What's so special about these eggs? They're one of the strongest tonics known to Kith. If you leave out Carrogalan, of course, not saying anyone should take that. But dragon eggs are known to make Kith bold, purposeful. Some even think they'll protect from Beowix. She shrugs. All I know is everyone's pining after potions made from dragon eggs. But the damn roads. Can't reach none of my suppliers, so I'm stuck with whatever I can scrounge up in the wood. Deercap, River Reed, and the like. I could get an egg for you. She keeps her gaze steady, but you see hope kindling in her eyes and twitching at the corners of her mouth. I sure hope you're not leading me on. I don't think I could stand getting burned again. She bites her lip. If you really mean to go after it, I'd certainly pay you. Just remember, big as they are, dragon eggs are fragile, and there's a lot more I can do with a whole one.
Hail and well met.
We've been here talking to you. She adjusts one of her bandages. Anything else I can do for you? I've got some handy ointments if you're braving the roads anytime soon. The egg is in a nest perched in a cliff on the east end of Dyrford Crossing. That's out in the wilds just east of here. I'm sure there are others elsewhere, but the one at Dyrford Crossing is just the age I need. If you head out that way, be careful. The place was crawling with worms when I went out there, and I can't imagine they've gone anywhere else. What's wrong with the roads? A noise of disgust rattles from her throat. Brigands, looters, you name it. The gods may be hollowing out our babies, but it's grown folk that's rubbing out the rest of us. People are scrambling to Defiance Bay because they hear there's healthy births there, and all the refugees in abandoned homes attract desperate sorts like flies on dog shit. I'm looking for an Orlin named Nefer. I did see an Orlin lady headed into the Dracogen Inn just the other day. She points across the road at a large building. Don't know what her name was, but she was acting real sneaky-like. Show me your wares. She steps aside. Sure thing. The shelves of her cart contain jars, vials, and bundled paper packets. I'm not gonna get anything right now. I'm just gonna look, see what there is. Okay. Yeah, we'll take that. nest egg. Bring new potions, okay. Hendinus Apothecary, okay. Well, we don't have that much time left, so I'm gonna finish, or continue, exploring outside some more before we go in anywhere. Phew, there's an odor that could scar the memories from your skull. Trigil's Cutiary. She's been missing for days. You people can't keep stonewalling us. And you can't just barge into our homes. We told you she's not there. At least we're not under some tyrant like those poor sods in Gilded Vale. Why does some highborn think we'll take his daughter? We've got enough trouble as it is. When these lords have problems, they blame honest Kith. Typical. Elder Antelope Horn. There's this bridge. Music must be coming from here. Winfith's Arms and Armory. Crap, we got caught. That wasn't worth the fruit. Okay, I'll stop. He's still questioning them. The Dracogen Inn.
Time to see and not be seen.
What? Hey.
I'm gonna leave it anyway.
Got it.
Damn Galloway for monsters like that, and damn the rest of the gods too. Rumbald. A man paces angrily in front of a wrecked animal pen, his sun-weathered face twisted with ire. He's so wrapped up in his fury that he doesn't seem to notice you. Galloway's slobbering beasts. Blazing bloody effigy. Thrice damned salty wench in her soggy... What's wrong? That monster stole my pigs, traipsed into the village, tore down my pen, and made off with the whole damned herd. Just left a few runts, and what am I supposed to do with them? Calm down and tell me what happened. He bites his lip and closes his eyes. His nostrils flare with each quick, angry breath. Wife's always telling me to mind my temper. Just breathe deep and count to 10. An ogre moved into the area not long ago. Folk had been seeing glimpses and tracks out in the wood, and it seemed to be staying away from town. So we all thought, until it made off with my pigs. Now everyone's afraid it's going to develop a taste for Kith, if it hasn't already. Did you see the ogre take your pigs? What else would have destroyed my pen and made off with my herd, and at the same time the rest of the village is seeing a 10-foot-tall monster in the forest? I know it's too late to get my pigs back, but it set my mind at ease to see that thing's head shorn from its neck. In fact, you bring its ugly pate to me, and I'll trade you for something that's of less use to a farmer like me than to a rowdy-looking sort like yourself. What do you know about the ogre? It's the same as any other, I'm sure. A big, ugly son of a bitch with a nasty temper and an appetite to match. Trigo could tell you more. He claims to have seen it in the wood. You can find him in his shop, right by the broken tower. Need something else? I've been sent to find an Orla named Nefer. Know where she is? Never even heard of her. Alright. Perhaps we can interrogate these pigs. I don't know why you can select them. I mean, they should make noise when you talk to them. Just an oink there would be cool. Dayden McLean. Let me guess. You see this man in the middle of the forest, back against a tree. His head is turned, and he strains to hear something. He turns his head the other direction and slowly slides down the tree, ending in a crouch. He cautiously moves forward, keeping to the shadows. His steps are silent as he gingerly places his feet between twigs and leaves. A grunting noise echoes through the quiet morning, and shuffling footsteps rustle as they approach him. He cranes his head around the trunk of the tree and spies his target. He edges his way around the tree, keeping it between him and his quarry. The shuffling comes closer, the grunting now accompanied by a wet snuffle. Bracing himself against the tree, he holds his position, waiting. Then, with almost supernatural grace, he pushes himself from the tree and swings around it to the right, practically running along its trunk, floating as he moves. He lands in front of the boar, rooting its way around the clearing, his knife flicking lightning quick across its neck. Before the startled animal can even react, he leaps onto its back, squeezing his knees into its sides and gripping the hair at the back of its neck. The beast starts to buck and tries to run from its attacker, but the man merely holds on and waits for the inevitable, enjoying the thrill of a hard-earned feast, thinking about what herbs would bring out the beast's natural flavors best. In seconds, the struggle is over, and the thrill is gone, replaced by the same dull craving that brought him here in the first place. It has left him faster even than the last time, and already he thinks about how he might top it. Fight drakes. That's more of a challenge. Hero. You see a man stumble, unfamiliar vestments tripping him. He pushes himself to his feet, unsteady, and continues along the empty road. His lips are chapped and dry, skin glazed with dust, but something about the rest, the set of his jaw, tells you that he is far yet to walk. As night stains the sky, he stops, whispering a fire into existence with the help of some wood. He attempts to sleep, staring into the stars. He continues in this fashion for several days, only occasionally drinking water from a goat skin as he moves. It takes him days to reach the temple, and when he does, his knees falter and give way, crashing him to the ground. The monks take him in, and he shares his tidings, meaningless to anyone but them, and when he is recovered, he begins anew, his strides strengthened with food and rest, mind clear with meditation and purpose, and a long way yet to walk. Okay. More river reed. And I think we've been over here. Yep. temporary. Inethal Silivar. Oh boy. You see a black-clad figure, bent low and moving slowly through a field. The figure holds a gleaming blade in his hand, keeping it hidden behind his back. He approaches another man who is crouched over, actions hidden by a large bush he has crawled halfway under. The figure stops moving as the man comes out from under the bush. You see that it is this man holding a handful of berries he has retrieved from a smaller bush that lies hidden in the overgrowth that surrounds it. He crawls back under the large bush, his arms moving again as he picks the berries. The figure begins moving again, slinking toward the man. He does not stop picking, but you see his head tilt very slightly to the side. He continues to work at the bush until the figure is almost on him. He backs out, hands full, and places the berries in the basket. Then he crouches before the basket, sorting the berries, removing leaves and any berry that doesn't look perfect. The figure comes up behind the man and raises the blade to strike. The man suddenly rocks back on his feet, spinning around to face the figure behind him. He grabs the figure's wrist and falls onto his back, planting a leg in the center of the figure's chest. The figure flies over the man and lands on his back in the dirt. The man is straddling the figure in an instant, his hands snapping out, hitting several points around the head and neck. The figure immediately falls unconscious. The man stands and retrieves the basket, collecting the berries and placing them back where they belong. Then he returns to picking. All right, then.
Got it. A
lot more river reed here. Hopefully it will be useful. I can't travel past this point, it seems. Okay. There's a couple guards over here. Of all the places for that girl to get lost, why'd she have to do it here? I don't know what's worse, the smell of the pigs or the smell of the people. Well, that's nice of you. Just want to finish exploring the outside. Then we'll only have to check these buildings, and yeah, we're done. Alright, so stay tuned for next episode when we explore the Trigil's Curiery, Dracogen Inn. We already went here to the mill. And Winfrith's Arms and Armory. And we saw the apothecary that's outside. Thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. And enduring, grow strong.